That was intense. Was that intense? That was kind of intense. Man, I'm telling you. Now, I'm going to make a prediction. I wasn't even going to go into announcements, but I'm going to this morning. I'm going to make a prediction that before this series is over with, we're going to have some moments at church, and it's going to be good because we haven't even started the Heaven series, and we're already doing some Only Imagine. And as we get a little bit further along in here, I believe we're going to have some pretty good moments. And so thank you, JT, and everybody that led us this morning. Awesome, awesome, awesome. And man, I'm telling you, that song has been around for a while now. But every time I sing it, I just think, man, do you ever just think about heaven? You ever just think about it? Now, look, even if you're an atheist in here this morning, you may not be thinking about it. In fact, if you're an atheist here this morning, I bet you're already freaked out. So just hang on. It's downhill from here. But if you're here this morning, you have any kind of spiritual bone in your body, you probably think at least a little bit about heaven. And we have people there. You've buried people. You've seen people die, and you've lost people. Some of them have been gone 30 and 40 years, and some just a few weeks or months. But when you think about heaven, it's incredible. I mean, really. And if they got anything right about that, which the whole song is right, but I can only imagine. And that's a true statement. You can only imagine. And so this morning, we're gonna start a series in heaven, on heaven. Colossians chapter 3 is where we're going to be. So if you have your Bibles, turn there. Let me make you mindful of a couple things while you're turning there. First of all, we had a great turnout for Sunday school this morning. They stopped me in the parking lot and said we had almost 200 folks here for Sunday. Whoa, did that sound funny to y'all or just me? That just sounded, listen, you had me just perfect just a few moments ago. Go back to whatever that was. But we had almost 200 people here, and that is awesome. And so I thank you for coming and being a part of this. I hope that you got off on the right foot for purpose-driven life. Let me say this to you. If you're here this morning, then make plans to be here on Wednesday night at 6:30. You can meet me right here. We're going to continue with the purpose-driven life, and I'm going to show the video of Rick Warren, and I'm going to talk to you through it. And so thank you for being here, and thank you for coming. Now, one of the things that we gave you, in case you weren't able to be here this morning, is we have a new little cardstock thing that we're trying to give you. And it's for Sunday school, but it's just if you're a guest, we want you to have this. And so it tells you a little bit about our church. On the back side of that, it'll also give you a list of Sunday school teachers. Now, here's the cool part. We made these before we did our survey. Since we've done our survey, we've actually had people sign up to be a Sunday school teacher. So their name's not on here. So there's even more Sunday school classes that we offer you now than we did last week. So it's a great time to get on board. And if you don't have one, pick one up this morning. They will make sure you get one, especially if you're a guest. If you're a guest, we want you to have one of those. And then in a few weeks, if you're a guest, we have a special gift for you that we're going to be getting you. And it's the coolest gift that any church is giving out around here. And so we're going to give you that in just a few weeks. Let me also say this to you. We have been talking about deacons for a while. We're needing some extra help. And so this week, if you have someone in church that you'd like to nominate for consideration of deacon, please turn their name in this week only. We're going to move quick on this because we need some help in the area of deacons. But if you know somebody that would make a great deacon, here's how you do it. A, you can call the church office, ask for PJ, give her your name and who you're nominating, or you can go to ilovemygrove.com and you can go to the info part there and send an email to info and say, hey, this is who I am. This is who I'd like to nominate as a deacon. Now, let me just say this to you. Just because you nominated them doesn't mean they're going to make it, okay? That's not against you or against the person that you're going to nominate, but there is a process, and we will go through that as well. But we are looking for some folks that would be willing to help serve. And then the deacons are going to put some people before you that in consideration for to be a deacon at the church. And then also, this is the last thing, and then we're going to get into heaven. And I'm telling you, man, I was driving down here from LC campus. I've already taught this lesson once. I've been studying on this for weeks now. And I pulled in the parking lot, was talking to a few guys out here, but then I started walking in here, and I was thinking about something that I said up there, and I got cold chills thinking about it. And that ever happens to me. I mean, thinking about, I don't ever get cold chills because of what I said, but it wasn't what I said. It was what I know to be true about heaven. And I'm just telling you, if your mind is open and your heart's open and you're willing to go with me over the next several weeks as we study heaven, I'm telling you, it's going to change your life forever, and it's going to set your life on an eternal path towards heaven. But let me say this to you before we get to heaven. PJ Naramore is my administrative assistant. Blake's wife and Willow's mom. And she is currently, as the Bible would say, with child. And so we're excited for them. And we're pumped. And I don't do this. We stopped doing this a long time ago where we make announcements about showers or weddings or whatever, because it became such a political thing that people were getting mad, but this and that, whatever. So we just stopped and we put brochures and cards and all that stuff out if you're having a thing, because we want to encourage people to come, but it just became hard to do it. However, PJ is my administrative assistant and she works for you, so I'm making a little exception, all right? And if you don't like it, I'm about to tell you about heaven. You're going to spend eternity with me anyway, so get over it real quick, all right? I'm making an exception. I'm making an exception to the rule, to my rule. I'm making an exception. She is going to have a baby, and so we want to throw her a baby shower. And she does a great job for you all day after day after day. You probably don't even know it, but she does. And so I'm very thankful for her, and I know her family is. But I'm excited for her and Blake and for little Willow and this new baby that is on her way, because it's a she. And so we're going to throw a baby shower for her next Sunday. Immediately after the service, we're going to have a shower. I guess it's over here in, no, it's right over here somewhere. It's in my, no, it's okay. It's going to be in the youth area on Kingston campus. See, the PJ wrote that. Thank you, PJ. It is in, see how good she is? I had a meeting this week on Tuesday morning. I was supposed to be at a school reading to a classroom at 8:30. I was supposed to be there at 8:15. At 8:30, they text me and said, did you forget about this morning? And I said, no, PJ forgot. But it wasn't PJ forgot. I forgot to tell PJ. If I'd have told PJ, I'd have been there. I missed it. Man. So anyways, next Sunday, we're going to have a baby shower for baby Naramore. And am I allowed to say her name? Her name is Tilly May. Tilly May Naramore. Little Tilly is on her way. So please come and take part in the baby shower for her. And then start praying big time, because come March, she's going to have that baby. And I'm going to be on my own here for a long time. And so the place could fall apart. All right, so y'all ready to go to heaven? You know, it's funny. Heaven is where all of us are going if you know Christ. If you don't know Christ, you ain't going. Well, that's pretty straightforward, wasn't it? Okay, and thanks for coming. Consider that an evangelistic message. What'd you get saved for?
He said we're all going to heaven, but I wasn't going to get to go. So I said, sign me up. And so I got saved.
Somebody said when I do that voice, they see the donkey on Shrek. So they said every Sunday the donkey comes out. I was in Haiti. They kept going. They walked me with the Haitians. They go, do the donkey voice. Do the donkey voice. I'm like, do the donkey voice. What do you? And then I couldn't do it when they made me do the donkey voice. And apparently I do the donkey voice. So anyways. But you know what the interesting thing about heaven is? Is everybody knows somebody there if you're a believer. And everybody wants to go, but nobody wants to go today. Now, isn't that funny? We have sold out, we have committed to it, but nobody wants to go today. Now, that's messed up. That if Jesus is there, but you don't want to go today, no wonder I can't get people to come to church, right? I mean, Jesus is here, you won't come here. He's in heaven, you don't want to go there. I mean, where you want to go? Walmart. I mean, you understand what I'm saying? So heaven is this weird shift in our thought process where you want to know it's there, you want to have it at the end of your life, but nobody wants to go today. And my goal is over the next several weeks to share with you some things about heaven that just quite possibly might make you want to go. That might change the way you look at life, might change the way you look at your problems. It might help answer some questions for you that you don't know about heaven. In fact, if I asked you to tell me about heaven, most of you cannot. And it's with that thought, if you're physically able, will you stand with me as we honor the reading of God's word? Colossians chapter 3, series that we're starting. Heaven, there's no place like home. Stole that from the Wizard of Oz, in case you're wondering. No place like home. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 1, therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Let's pray. God, I love you. As we set off as a church to study the purpose-driven life in Sunday school and in small groups, God, as we set off to study about heaven as a church corporately, I pray that you would help people come together, that they would understand they have a purpose, that life isn't just about pain, but not only do we have a purpose, but we have a place, and our place is with you. So inspire us, encourage us. God, set our hearts on fire to be where you are. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Heaven. So heaven's an interesting concept. Heaven is one of those concepts where really you're probably uncomfortable talking about it. I mean, if you think about it, people don't even talk about heaven that much, right? You might talk about hell a little bit more than you talk about heaven, but we're all headed to heaven, right? You put a lot of thought in where you're headed. Most of us put a lot of thought in where we're headed. Did you realize that in Scripture, that heaven is so important that there's over 500 references to heaven in Scripture, over 500. In fact, in the Bible, 54 books in the Bible mention heaven at some point. Now, there's three different terms for heaven, but in this particular understanding, we're talking about heaven as in the place to where we're going. Not just that the heavens parted, or talking about the sky, or any of that stuff. We're talking about the place where God dwells, heaven. It is the last place we will go. In fact, as we talk about heaven, most of us are confused. I mean, if we talk about the golden streets you're in, we talk about the pearly gates, and the pearly gates are kind of cool because we understand that the pearly gates are huge and they're made out of a single pearl. That's weird. Now, you try to put your mind on that, right? And just think about it. Some of you guys have bought your wife pearls before, and you know how expensive they were, Tennessee pearls especially, right? Can you imagine a gate out of a single pearl? You can't afford it, just in case you're wondering. But it's where God dwells. That there's streets literally with gold. That's pretty awesome. There's a crystal sea. That's pretty crazy, right? Then there's angels. And these angels are weird, dude. To say the least, they're weird. A lot of wings, a lot of eyeballs, a lot of that stuff going on. The Bible says right now that they're just singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty," over and over and over and over. Now, that's hard to imagine. Most of y'all can't imagine that. You think about heaven as being the place you're going to be for eternity. What's eternity? Forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. You can't even wrap your mind around that. See, it's hard to explain, but everybody's going, right? You start talking about people you know that are in heaven. Where are they? Well, they're in heaven. What is heaven? I don't know. It's up there where Jesus is. Well, is it paradise or is it heaven? Well, what's with this term paradise, right? I mean, didn't Jesus tell the guy on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise"? But isn't there a place called heaven? Now, what about this? The Bible says that there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. Well, now that's messed up. Because if I'm going to heaven, then I'm leaving the earth and I'm going to be in heaven, but there's going to be a new earth. Who's going to be on the new earth? Are y'all confused yet? Yeah, you are a little bit. Don't look at me so spiritual this morning. I know you're confused because I've been in this for weeks and I'm going, it's confusing. Right? Do all dogs go to heaven? I've asked this question. I've got more tread out of that one comment. People want to know about their dogs. Right? You know, and maybe if we can answer that question, you won't pay lots of money to have, you know, Fido, you know, cloned or whatever. Right? But do they go to heaven? There's a Disney movie out when I was a little boy. It said all dogs went to heaven. So maybe they do. Which is a problem for some of you guys. Because you beat on that thing. Remember when you were trying to train him in the house? What do you do with the dog when it's just rub his nose in it? That dude's going to meet you at the pearly gates. What do you think about that? You know what I mean? That's messed up, dude. Right? I mean, are there animals in heaven? I mean, are there? Maybe there is. Maybe there isn't. Most of you all would say, they don't have souls. And then some of you are going to say, yeah, please, I love animals. You know, you're one of those folks. You know, you're always sharing cats on Facebook. And we're all like, get over it, dude. We don't even like them, you know. But that's where you are. So, I mean, you can't answer that. In fact, you may not be a believer today, but you believe in heaven. You say, well, I don't know. Yeah, you do. Because you may not say heaven, but you say things like this: when somebody has died and they're buried there, or their body's there before they're buried, you know what you'll say? You'll say things like this: I know you're not a spiritual person. I've seen you before, and you know you're not a spiritual person. But you know what you try to do? You try to think about forever, and here's what you say: they're in a better place. How do you know? I mean, how do you know that? You want it to be true. Well, what's a better place? I would argue that for some of you right now, you're scared that heaven is not a better place. In fact, one of the reasons you don't want to go right now is because heaven can't compete with what you've already created for yourself. You've created heaven on earth. One of the reasons that we're struggling to even think about heaven or talk about heaven is because of what you're going to have to give up to go. You ever heard somebody say this? Well, when we get to heaven, will we get to have pizza? Is there going to be pizza? I can't imagine heaven without pizza. I mean, it's my favorite. Right? Or McDonald's French fries, are they going to be in heaven? Right? A little salt. Are there calories in heaven? Right? You say things, you talk about things. When I get to heaven, am I going to get to play golf? I mean, if there's no golf in heaven, I don't want to go. Right? Some of you are looking forward to that. Right? You want to know, I mean, are we going to be able to fish? Are we going to play? What are we going to do? You know what the Bible says about heaven? This morning is our introduction, and here's the question I ask. Why is it important to study heaven? I want to give you three reasons that we need to study heaven today. I want to give you three reasons that we need to focus on it, and three things that are going to help us as we unpack it, because I'm going to try to answer all those things that I just threw out to you this morning. What are you looking forward to? See, here's what the Bible says. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 3:11, and I'm going to get fired up at times, but probably over the next several weeks, I'm going to do a lot of teaching, so I'm going to do some reading, I'm going to share some things with you, and it may not be your style, but pay attention. Here's the reason is because most of you don't know half of what you think you know about heaven, and yet you have committed your eternity there. You wouldn't even do that if you were going on a beach vacation this summer, right? Some of y'all go on a trip of a lifetime, and you call, you text, anybody know of a good place to eat? What route? Should I fly there? Should I rent a car? Should I drive there? What should we do? I mean, you put more time investing on something that's going to be 7 days of your life forever as opposed to investigating out what's going to be your life for eternity. And the question is, if heaven is so great, why don't we want to go? Why? You don't want to go today?
Well, I'm going to have to give up my family. I'm going to have to give up my kids. I'm going to have to give up this, whatever.
It's all about but you know what the Bible says? The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 3:11, he has made everything appropriate in its time. He has also set eternity in their heart. One of the ways that you're created is that you're created with eternity in mind. You're created with what's next. You're created with what happens to you. You're created to think about it, to ponder on it, to question it. You think about it at different times, and most of us don't think about it often because we're so into here. But the moment that something arises in our life, we think about what's next. We think about heaven. We think about where we're headed. There's nobody really that just sits around and when somebody dies, go, well, I hope they have a blast in hell. Nobody says that. And even if you think someone didn't go to heaven, that they probably went somewhere else, you don't talk about it. In fact, what you say is things like this: well, nobody really knows. I know I'm stepping on toes, and I'm not trying to make you doubtful this morning. I'm just talking to you. This is in your spirit. It is the way you're created to wonder what's next. You take an atheist like I picked on a few moments ago. They have eternity in their heart, and their eternity is this, that it's over. You cease to exist. When you die, that's it. Now, if that's your answer for eternity, what a waste. I mean, what a stinking waste. I mean, you may not be the best believer in the world. You may not be where you need to be spiritually, but come on. I mean, if your answer to human life, as precious as it is you get 80 years and then just gone, that's messed up. That's messed up, right? Why you feel as bad as you do? Because there's something inside of you that says there's something after this. Why is it that people can live a terrible life, but at the end of their life, they want to get things right? Why is it somebody can go to jail and be on death row, and yet in that moment, they're crying out to anything, religion, any religion? Why? Because they're preparing for the next life. There's something inside of me that says there's more here, right? And for believers, We know that that's where Jesus is, and that's where we're going to spend forever, not a block of 80 years or 50 years, but forever. And for believers, we've already got people that are there. They're already there. Why on heaven's name, why do you not know what heaven is like? Why do you not know? These are the questions I begin to ask and I begin to look at because I wanted to know. In fact, Philippians 3:20 says this, "For our citizenship is in heaven, from which also we eagerly wait for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into the conformity with the body of his glory." So here's what he says. He says, I don't know why you're worried about now, because this isn't even your place of citizenship. Your citizenship is in heaven. That's where you are a citizen, right? You wouldn't know it by looking at our cars, because our cars say we are citizens of Kingston, because we got a K on our car. Right? Don't look so spiritual this morning. You're saying, yes, that's exactly right. Yes, I am. Right? Right? You park by somebody that's got a Midway sticker on the back of their car and you said, boo. Because you're a Kingston. Right? Yeah. I mean, you know what we do is we become citizens here and you forget about your citizenship in heaven. But the Bible says that you're a citizen there. Now, here's a problem. Here's a question about heaven that you're not ready to answer. I know you're not ready to answer. You're going to try to answer it, but you don't know how to answer it. And then you're going to say, well, let's just ask the preacher. The Bible says that when you die, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. But we've all been at the graveside, and we know that your body went in the ground. So your body went in the ground and is decaying, but something of you went to be with to heaven to be with Jesus. That would be your soul. But then the Bible also says that when Christ returns, remember, here's what he says, Paul says to the people of Thessaloniki in 1 Thessalonians, he says, don't grieve like the rest of the world grieves, because we know and have this assurance and comfort one another with these words, that when Christ returns, the dead in Christ shall rise first, right? And be joined in the air. So somehow, some way, when Jesus returns, there's going to be a shout, trumpet, my soul is going to leave heaven, find my decaying body. Are y'all with me? Doesn't that sound absolutely normal? So we're going to connect. This graveyard's going to look funny, right? It's going to be like Michael Jackson's Thriller. I was about to. Y'all know where I was heading. Y'all thinking it right now in your head. You can see it. Okay, come back. So here we are. But then the Bible says that our bodies are going to be transformed into his glory. So what in the world is going on? Let me ask you another question. Some of you have had miscarriages. You ever thought about that? You ever thought about when you get to heaven, Mom? You don't know if it was a boy or a girl. God does. You ever thought about that? When you get to heaven and there's your little boy or little girl that you grieved, and everybody said, time will help, time will heal, you'll have babies, but you never forgot, and it's always hurt your heart. And you get to heaven and there they are. Are you with me? Or are they a baby? Or are they grown? Do they have a child's body or do they have an adult's body? How do you know? What about this? Some of you have put spouses in heaven, and you're looking forward to getting there. But the Bible says that we will not be given to marriage in heaven. How's that work out? How does that work out? Right? I mean, you get to, you know, go to heaven. Your spouse is there. You're looking forward to getting to heaven because they're going to be there. Are you going to be married when you get there? Are they going to know you? The Bible says you'll be known as you were known. What's that mean? Some of you better hope not. There's that liar. Never liked him. You couldn't even get to heaven and not be a liar. You're a liar. See it on your face. Right? What does that mean? Now, let me ask you a question. Are you ready to tell everybody where you're going and what it's going to be like? No, you can't answer those questions. Right? Those folks that you got a phone call and they died too soon. Are you with me? And we've said they're in a better place. They're in heaven. What are they doing? What's it going to be like when you're absent from the body and the presence of the Lord and your friends and your family and all that stuff's there? What's that going to be like? right? See, it's so important. It's where you're headed. It's where you're going. And we don't even know. We would not do this on a trip to Chattanooga. We would know, but you're going to heaven. That's where my citizenship is. John 14, here's what Jesus says. He says, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's where Jesus is. Jesus is in heaven. Now, can you imagine if I had Jesus on the other side of this wall, and here's what I said. Hey, listen, y'all. I got Jesus, and he's over here in Drew Stockton's old Sunday school room. He's just over there waiting on us to come. How many of y'all would say, tell him we'll be over there in about 15 minutes? Oh, you want me to tell Jesus to wait? Yeah, we got some things going on over here. No, you wouldn't. You would just be running, I would think. If you weren't, that might. Anyways. But you would run. Yet the Bible says he's in heaven, and we can be with him, but nobody wants to go yet. Isn't that weird? It's weird. So what's going on? The Bible says that you can be there too. The Bible speaks of Colossians. So let's study a few minutes this morning. I want to give you an introduction why it is important to study heaven. Then I'm going to let you out, let you go today. We're going to stay on this. I want you to begin to rattle your minds and your hearts about heaven. Hopefully, as you walk out of here today, you're going to be encouraged and thought. Maybe later on today you have goosebumps like I did, just coming down the road thinking about stuff and just thinking about what I'm about to share with you. I'm so pumped about it. I'm just going to tell you something right now. It's kind of a morbid thing to even say, but I look forward to heaven. Man, I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to it. So the Bible teaches us in Colossians chapter 3. Y'all ready to study a little bit this morning? I'm prepared. Y'all ready? Here we go. We're going to dig deep. If you don't have a Bible, find somebody close to you. Pull it up on your phone, whatever you need to do. But let's study here for just a few moments this morning. The Bible says in verse 1, Colossians chapter 3, why it is important to study heaven. Three reasons, but let's look at something first. The Bible says, therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above. Keep seeking the things above. The term keep seeking is translated set your hearts. Now, some of your Bibles, it doesn't say keep seeking in the first verse. It says set your hearts. Mine says keep seeking, but the translation is set your hearts. You need to know that because in verse 2 it says set your mind. So the Bible has this understanding of setting your mind and setting your heart on heaven, that we should be as believers thinking of heaven and loving heaven, that our minds should be set on heaven. That's what it ought to look like. Randy Alcorn said this, too long to long for Christ is to long for heaven, for that is where we will be with him. We cannot set our eyes on heaven, on Christ, without setting our eyes on heaven. And we cannot set our eyes on heaven without setting our eyes on Christ. Still, it is not only Christ, but the things above we are to set our minds on. Our minds should be set on heaven. When he uses the words things above in Scripture, he's talking about heaven. You can take those two words, things above, and make them heaven. I'm teaching here this morning. So what we need to understand first of all is when he says to keep seeking, he's literally saying set your heart, and then he says set your mind on things above. Things above is heaven. And so Paul tells the people at Colossae, now get with me because this is what we're coming back to all month long and all February long. We are going to have a mind and a heart that is in heaven. And I'm going to tell you something. You may not believe this now, but some of you, we're going to study so good, you're going to learn so many great things that once your mind sees where it's in heaven and once your heart goes in towards heaven, it is going to absolutely wreck your life. And you're going to finally be able with Paul. See, most of us in here have never understood how Paul could say, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Gain. You've never been able to look yourself in the eyes and say, if I die, it's gain. We struggle with the to live for Christ hard too. But most of us say, for me to live is Christ, but to die is to lose. I lose my family. I lose my hobbies. I lose my children if I die. If cancer gets me and it rocks my world and takes me to the threshold of death, I'm fearful because of everything that I'm going to lose. Doc Holliday last night on TV. It was funny, I was talking about heaven. The Wyatt Earp with Kevin Costner, the one that's not as good as Tombstone. Y'all with me? It's like you want to love Kevin Costner, but then you see that and you're like, really? I mean, Val Kilmer killed it in Tombstone, you know? Nobody ever wanted to be like a guy with tuberculosis till you seen Val Kilmer and Doc Holliday. And then you just sit in your bedroom and you act like you're smoking a cigarette and coughing at the same time. You are Doc Holliday. You know what I mean? Is it just me? It's just me. I've done that. In the donkey voice. Hey, man. So, he says, Doc Holliday says last night, while I'm working and I'm just sitting there looking over my stuff and rereading some stuff because I'm so just pumped and reading ahead and doing all this stuff. And he's talking about death. And he says, death stares at it all. He said, I'll stare death in the face. And he says, sometimes it doesn't look half bad. I heard him say it. Dennis Quaid, I believe, the guy. And you know what? It would be amazing if we go through this whole thing and no matter what happens in our life, we could look at death and say, gang. You ever read about the martyrs in Christ who stood? They were burned at the stake, and yet they never made a noise. The disciples are crucified upside down, filleted, boiled, and they never, nothing. They never run. Why? Because they knew what was coming next was better than what they're giving up. Right? And there ain't nobody walked in here this morning and said, gang! Wait a minute, I need to get some things in order. But he says, we just set our minds on it. Set your hearts is a Greek term, zeto, Z-E-T-E-O. And you need to know this because when we set our hearts, that's why it's important that you see that it doesn't just say keep seeking, but set our hearts or set your hearts and then set your minds. There's a Greek term in here that is present tense, and you need to see this. It denotes man's general philosophical search or quest. When Paul writes this to these believers, you're learning this morning, we're going deep. He's writing to these people in Colossae, and they understand the terminology. And what he's saying is, you need to set your mind and your heart on heaven in such a way as a man who is on a quest, who is on a search. Now, this search is diligent, active, and single-minded. I have become single-minded towards heaven. Now, I'm going to argue here in just a few moments that not only is this not radical thinking to us, but up until about 100 years ago, nobody had a problem with this. Most everybody was living life thinking about heaven. It hasn't been until the past 100 years or so that we have created such a comfortable life on earth that we no longer look forward to heaven there. So he says to them, you need to be on a single-minded, you're on a journey, you're on a search to heaven. It's present tense, meaning that you have to keep doing it. You constantly are seeking heaven. You're constantly thinking about heaven. In fact, this term is so strong that Jesus uses the same term in Luke 19, verse 10, when he says, the Son of Man came to seek that which was lost. So the same intensity in which Christ came to earth to save you is the same intensity in which you should walk through earth thinking about heaven. Am I talking this morning? That's intense. There's nobody I met today that's walking around going, I can't wait to get there, man. I'm just putting up with life. I'm putting up with it. Did you get a new car? Yeah, and I'm just putting up with it. What you talking about? Is the guy heated seat? Yeah, and I'm just having to put up with that. Has he got cruise control? Unbelievable. It almost drives itself. That's pretty awesome. I'm just putting up with it. What you talking about? I got heaven. I mean, that ain't even an appetizer, right? I'm just putting up with it till I get there, right? Because I am so intent on finding heaven. Matthew 18, 12 uses the same term when the shepherd looks for his lost sheep. He leaves everybody else to go after the one. It's the same intensity in which we should be searching for heaven. Luke 15, 8 talks about the woman who searched for the lost coin. Same intensity that we should be looking for heaven. Matthew 13, 45, a merchant that searches for a fine pearl. We should be looking for heaven intently. Now, I'm going to argue this. You already are. And the problem is, Most of you think you've already found it. And the reason you start looking for heaven above is because you've created heaven here. That's a good word. See, when heaven is part of who we are created to be, to search for, and when God commands us to search for it, guess what? Those two worlds are going to combine. At some point, you're going to be searching for something. And here's what's going to happen. You want heaven so bad, it's the only thing that will complete you. You remember Jerry Maguire? You complete me. The truth of the matter is heaven is what completes you. You will never fully be satisfied. You will never experience full joy. You will never experience the fullness of life until you're standing in heaven face to face with Jesus Christ. And because you are on a constant search for that, you have begun to create heaven here on earth. The reason that you do not want to go to God's heaven is because you'd have to give up your own heaven. So he says, seek it. Now, if you're going to spend the next lifetime living in heaven, why not spend this lifetime seeking heaven so you can eagerly anticipate and prepare for it? I mean, if I'm going there, I want to prepare, right? Don't you? If I'm headed there, I want to prepare. So, three reasons that we need to study heaven. Number one, that wasn't one of the reasons. Y'all ready? I know you're looking at your clock. Heaven's longer. Here we go. This may be the only way you're prepared. You're here forever. That's all right. We got a jump start. We've sat through Philip's sermons. All right, here we go. Number one, the reason we need to study and seek heaven is our misconceptions of heaven are crippling us. They're crippling us. Your misconception. We are full of misconceptions. Misconception number one is you can't know much about heaven. The thought that you can't know much about it causes you not to study for it. The thought that you can't know much about heaven because nobody's ever been there causes you not to think about it, right? Well, you can't know much, so you don't think about it much. However, that's where we're headed. It's a misconception. There's tons that you can know. There's over 500 passages in Scripture. There's over 54 books in the Bible that have understanding of heaven. Jesus talked about heaven. You can understand more than you possibly can imagine. You just don't put forward because you're already thinking that you can't know much about heaven. And you've probably heard people teach about heaven, and it's just messed you up, so you don't think about it. So misconception number one is you don't study much because you don't think you can know much. But number two is there's a misconception that heaven is totally disconnected and different than anything we experience here in this life. So we don't think about it much. You ever thought about what heaven looks like? Hollywood tries to help us. Different people try to help us think about heaven. I mean, think about it. Heaven is weird. If you think about what you've seen on TV or what you've thought of in your mind. Right now, I want you just to, in your mind, think about what heaven looks like. Isn't it white? Everybody went to white. You just click white. Everybody in here, white. Isn't there a fog machine? I guarantee you it's foggy. Whatever you're thinking, right? You're going to die, and St. Peter's going to go, shh, right before you show up. You're going to be laying in an ICU unit one day, and there's going to be a nurse going, it's okay, your whole family's here, and you're going to go, okay. And you're going to take your last breath, and in that moment, you're going to hear, shh, fog machine, and you're going to wake up in a foggy daze in heaven, right? That's what you think. You've seen thoughts. You've never seen the floor of heaven. In your mind, you've never. It's always foggy. Just walk around kicking fog. Everyone's in a white robe. Right? Walk around in white robes. Everyone's in a white robe. Some people got wings. If you watch It's a Wonderful Life, you got to earn them. Some of y'all are on the harp committee. When you get there, you get in the harp. I mean, how boring is that, dude? Like, you make it to heaven, you've been looking forward to seeing, like, I'm looking forward to seeing my people. Look, if I get to heaven and my people's like over in the corner of heaven and it's just foggy mess and it's foggy on the bottom and he's over there going, brr, brr, and I go, people, brr, how long you been doing that? Forever. Brr. I'm like, oh, the calluses. I mean, no, that just sounds no fun, right? The gates are huge, so you're going to get up there and there's going to be a line because a bunch of people died at the same time, so you're in the back of the line waiting to get in, right? Right? And the gate, and it's like, yeah, this is what happens in my heaven, all right? George Burns is there. He's there. You all don't know who that is. He's got a cigar. You don't know. It's a foggy mess. Some people are sitting on clouds, I don't know. And all the angels are, well, I grew up in the 80s, and my mother used to collect angels, and they were called cherubims, and they were fat babies. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all still have them at the house. Every angel is a little fat Gerber baby, making different poses. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Now, you have the opportunity this summer to go deep sea fishing and catch that sailfish you've been after, put it on your wall, or go hang out with the cherubims and my peepaw who's playing the harp. What are you going to choose? I'll be there when I get there, right? It's a misconception. And another misconception is that it's boring. I mean, why in the world would you want to go to heaven? It's just one long church service. Some of y'all come to church and we sing too much music here. Can you imagine when you get to heaven? I mean, the angels have been, you know, holy, holy, holy forever and ever and ever. You're about to get involved in that. It's too loud. It's not loud enough. It's, you know, I mean, church, you all are here till we try to get out of here. I'm not even going to say what time, but we try. And you know what? You walk out, y'all are faithful. I do say that. You are faithful. But everybody else that doesn't show up say, that church service is too long. I can't believe anybody go down there. I got church to do. You know what I mean? And you're going to go to heaven. You can't leave early. Right? It's boring. Now, it's boring. I mean, really, if everything that I just described to you, that is a boring, boring place, and compared to the life that I live right now, that is not exciting, and I guess I'll go. I mean, if it's that or hell, I'll go to the fog machine, you know what I mean? I don't want to go there. That hurts. I mean, at least I, you know. So our misconceptions are crippling us. And so what happens is when we think like that, then we don't pursue it. We don't want it. We don't look for it, right? So what happens is in most of our misconceptions, it causes us to live a life where we want other things first. I can remember, you know, I was afraid that I would, Jesus would come back before I got my driver's license. I always wanted to drive, you know. So I'm 15. My fear was I'd be standing in line at the DMV for like an hour and a half. You know, this would be my luck. And I'm about to get my license and drive myself home. And then the Lord comes back. What? Right? Some of y'all, you know, you want to get married. So you say, well, I, the Lord could come back or I can go to heaven. I just want to get married first. Or you want to have kids first. Now you pray for heaven every day, don't you, right? It's like, anytime, Lord, come back, please, come back. It's bedtime. This would be a great time. I can't get that thing to go to bed. Come back, Jesus. You are spiritual at 9:30 every day during the week. That's your most spiritual time because you're dealing with the prince of chaos, right? So what happens is you build this whole life, and your whole life, instead of wanting to be in God's heaven, is it's a heaven that causes you to want to stay here. You build heaven here. It may not sound like a problem, but it causes us to have a temporal attitude instead of an eternal perspective. We fix our energy on the here and now and focus on the life we have been given here. And the truth is, this is a new concept. In fact, when you look through Scripture and you look through the history of time, men hundreds of years ago taught more about heaven than they did earth. It wasn't until the last 100 years that we begin to talk more about earth than we do heaven. Why? Because we've taken heaven from where it's supposed to be and brought it here, and you've fallen so much in love with the heaven that you built for yourself, you don't want the heaven that Jesus Christ has prepared for you. Man, that's a good word. Why in the world would you want to pursue heaven when you can go home and you're in heaven? And I got to be honest with you, we do live in a beautiful place, and we do have the water, and we do have fishing, and we do have a summer that no one else can compete with. We have some of the greatest things and place to live on the planet. And if God's sunset in heaven is better than the sunset across the lake, he's going to have to do something special. That point drives home the reason that many of us are not seeking heaven. We've got it good here. Why in the world would you give this up? See, hundreds of years ago, they were looking forward to heaven. You know why? Because they didn't have anything. And you know what? In the best case scenario, worst case scenario, you still have it better than they had. But we've created our own heavens here. We pursue our own heavens here. Under the pressures and the pleasures of this life, we focus on now as if this will go on forever. And although we know that not to be true, we lose sight of the next life. We lose sight of eternal life. We lose sight of heaven. Chip Ingram said it this way: as we have gotten more comfortable with life here on earth, we have less desire for life there in heaven. We've become so comfortable with here on earth that we have no desire here in heaven, right? Listen to this. This is a great quote. By the way, I'm back on Twitter. I was thinking about that because I thought this would be a great place to quote that. Just tweet it out. Right, give the president run for his money. I'm at Real J. Phillip, in case you're wondering. Follow me. I come in, I told Tyler today, the other day, I was so proud of myself because I don't do social media, but I really want to read the Twitter stuff because they're quoting it all the time. So I was like, I can get back on there. Well, I had a Twitter account that set up years ago, whatever, and I couldn't remember none of it. And so being as technical as I am, I started over. And so there's another me out there somewhere. Forever and ever. So I started, and I come in, and Tyler goes, "That's good. What's your whatever? What is that called? Your tweet name or whatever? I don't even know what you call it." But I said, "I'm at Real J. Phillip." He said, "You used Real." I said, "I'm him. Why wouldn't I?" He was like, "Only like celebrities use Real." I said, "Well, at Real J. Phillip did. So there you go." Listen to this. Stability in life jades our view of heaven. Your stable life has messed up your view of heaven. You say, well, my life's not stable. Maybe you say this, my life's dysfunctional. Maybe your life is dysfunctional, but I'm going to tell you something. Everybody in this room has a stable life. You say, you don't understand. It's not stable. You may think it's not stable, but it's stable. No, man, it's not stable. Yeah, it is. In fact, if you don't believe me, I'll tell you what you do. You take me up on this. You sign up for Haiti, I'm going to take you to where it's not stable. You just go with me. See, now your life is more stable than you think. Even on your worst day, you can get into a hotel room if you have to. You can have a roof over your head. It's dysfunctional, but it's stable. You can count on certain things. You may not like your life, but it's stable. And you know what? Here's a great quote. The stability in life jades our view of heaven. You said, no, it don't. I said, yeah, it does. In fact, I can prove it. Unstable lives changes your view of heaven. You said, what do you mean? Here's what I mean. You walk in here today, you're not talking about heaven, you're not thinking about heaven, you're definitely not saying for me to die is gain. You're not saying that. But if you walk into your doctor's appointment this week that you have set up and they set you down across from your husband or your wife, or they set your son or your daughter down, or they set up whoever it is in your life and they say this, you have stage 4 cancer, immediately your view of heaven just changed. Immediately. Immediately the way you talk about heaven, the way you value heaven, the way you value eternity changed. See, when you're stable and you're living in a stable life, you don't worry about the next life because you are so involved in this one. But the moment that something makes your life unstable, cancer, tragedy, loss, hurt, pain, you begin to talk about heaven. You desire heaven more than you've ever desired it in all your life. That's how come you take a person that's in a perfectly good marriage, the marriage goes on the rocks, everybody's wanting out, you go through a divorce, and you know what? You take that stable person that was in the marriage before and you add divorce in their life, and you know what they're wanting to do? They don't want to live anymore. Why? Because their perspective of eternity just changed. It just changed. It's the same reason. You take somebody that buries a spouse. They were living a life. They were going places. They were vacationing together. They were buying this, doing this. It was great. They were selfieing on Facebook pictures, and they were the best life ever. You've had them over to your house. You've eaten dinner with them and all this other kind of stuff. But the moment that they walk through that cemetery and lower that person into the ground, you know what happens? They don't want to live anymore. They want to go where their spouse was. Why? Because their spouse was their heaven. That's why when we bury a child, you never get over it. Why? Were you thinking of heaven before that? Not really. I was enjoying my life here. Why do you want to go to heaven now? Because that's where my son is. It's where my daughter is. See, stability in life jades our view of eternity. See, some of you, all your lives are falling apart. God's taking things away from you. He's purging things. You're losing things. And you're going, where's God? And you know what God's saying? Hey, I'm right here, but you've been so focused on your heaven, I'm removing stuff so that you can lift your eyes and see me again. That's a good word. See, some of us in here, you're going through pain, and you don't know why. You're losing everything you ever held on to, and you're going, God's not a good God. He's not a great God. And you know what God says? Yes, I am. I'm a loving God. I'm a great God. I love you so much, I'm going to take away your heaven you're building for yourself so that you can have my heaven that I'm building for you. So, sometimes when your world is not stable, it's not that God's trying to be mean to you. He's loving you. And instead of standing around going, where's God? Kicking rocks. You know what he's doing? Come on. Raise your eyes. Come on. Up here. Up here. You know, that's what he said. Up here. Up here. And all of a sudden, my instability in life makes my heart want heaven. Right? Number two, we are commanded to study and think about heaven. So number one, misconceptions are killing us. Number two, we are commanded to study and think about heaven. So what's he say? He says, therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above. Where Christ is seated at the right hand, set your mind on the things above, not on the things that are on earth. God gives us a command. The whole point of Colossians 3, the first verses, is a command. God is commanding us to think about heaven. Why? God always commands, God's commands are always for our benefit. He commands us to diligently search for heaven, constantly to have a heavenly attitude or thought. Why? The command reinstates and implies there's nothing automatic about setting our minds on heaven. Why does God command you to think about heaven? Because you naturally won't on your own. You ever thought about it? There's nobody in here thinking, you know what, after service, I'm going to jump off a bridge. Just think I'm just going to jump. You're not thinking that way. In fact, later on, I'll see you and say, hey, I thought you were going to jump off a bridge. Why didn't you? Well, the Bible said don't jump off bridges. No, it doesn't say that. Well, it should. Why doesn't the Bible tell me not to jump off a bridge? Because you're not going to naturally go jump off a bridge. Right? It's not just how you wake up. The Bible doesn't say don't pet alligators. Right? You know? It's not like we're going to say, hey, this Wednesday night, come, you know, join us for the purpose-driven life. And while you're here, pet our 12-foot alligator. His name's Gus. Right? I just named him. And so you go out back, and there's an alligator there. And he's huge, man. 12-foot. Man, swamp people would like to catch him. Right? I say, come on, pet the alligator. And you go, I'm good. Why not? Jesus told me not to. No, he didn't. Well, why didn't he? Because he knows you ain't going to pet alligators. He don't tell you to do something you ain't going to do, right? And if your brain says, I think I'll pet that alligator, Jesus says, you deserve everything that's coming to you from that point forward. You're on your own, right? So what does Jesus do? Jesus always commands us to do the things that we won't naturally do. And you do not naturally think about heaven. You don't naturally do it. You never are driving down the road. Somebody call you. Hey, what are you doing? I was just sitting here thinking about heaven. What? Yeah, I was just thinking about the fog machine. Can't wait. No! You do not naturally think about heaven. You think about heaven when you need to. When somebody dies, they go to a better place. So what does God do? God says, you are supposed to. You have to think about heaven. You have to get your mind and your heart in heaven. C.S. Lewis said it this way. Listen to this. Now I'm going to give you the last point. We're finished. He says this. If you read history, you will find that Christians who did most for the present world were just those who thought most of the next. The apostles themselves who set on foot the conversion of the Roman Empire, the great men who built up the Middle Ages, the English evangelicals who abolished the slave trade, all left their mark on earth precisely because their minds were occupied with heaven. It is since Christians have largely ceased to think of the other world, heaven, that they have become so ineffective in this world, earth. That's a good word. Some of y'all wondering, why aren't we doing what we've seen? Why isn't the Great Awakening happening these days? Why don't we see people willing to evangelize like they did at the Roman Empire? Why aren't we seeing the Crusades like we saw? Because people's minds have changed. They begin to think more about earth than they have heaven. C.S. Lewis says this, aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you will get neither. I want you to hear what I'm about to tell you. Some of you, I do not believe this whole place is saved this morning. So you sound very judgmental. Well, okay. Everybody's judgmental today, I guess. I don't know. But trust me when I say this to you. You're going to hope that somebody would say that to you than to find it out when you have your last breath. But I want you to hear what I'm about to say. Some of you are just dilly-dallying around. You know what the truth is, but you won't accept Jesus as your Savior because you think you're too smart. But I'm going to tell you, and I want you to hear my words and write them down. Keep them with you. So I hope it keeps you up tonight. This is as close to heaven as you'll ever get. As messed up as your life is, this is as good as it'll ever be. But for those of us who know Christ, it only gets better from here. Gets gooder. Right? On your best day, it's not as good as it's going to be. On your worst day, you got something better waiting on you. And you know what? If we could ever get this church to raise its eyes up to say, we're not aiming at earth, we're aiming at heaven. You know what the Bible says, or what the Bible teaches, or what C.S. Lewis reminds us? We aim at heaven, we get earth thrown in. But if we aim here, we miss out on everything. He went on and said, most of us find it very difficult to want heaven at all, except insofar as means meeting our friends who have died. One reason for this difficulty is that we have not been trained. Our whole education tends to fix our minds on this world. And another reason is that when the real want for heaven is present in us, we do not recognize it. Did you know there's something inside of you that desires heaven? And this is our third point. We must study about heaven, not only because of our misconceptions, which I'm going to begin to address next week, not only because God commands it, which we need to raise our eyes to heaven, but number three, when you don't study heaven and know what heaven is about, you waste your life. You waste your life. Third thing is, when you don't study or seek heaven, you waste your life. Before Jesus leaves, whoever's doing our invitation, come on, JT, get on up here. Before Jesus heads back into eternity, he has a meeting with his disciples, John 14. Jesus is about to be crucified. He's about to die. And he's going to resurrect 3 days later. Then he's going to spend 40 days on the planet with these disciples. Now, the Bible teaches us that he has 12 disciples, one of which in John 14. Right before that, in John 13, he's already told Judas to go do what he's got to do. So now he's down to 11. And he's going to leave the future of the gospel in the hands of these disciples. Now, Jesus knows he's going to die, he's going to be buried, he's going to resurrect in 3 days, and then he's going to return or be here for 40 days. But in those 3 days, a lot of things can happen. In fact, he's dealing with these disciples, and these disciples are jokers, man. They doubt. They don't have a clue. In fact, the reason we have so many double print of these parables is because Jesus would tell a parable, and it was the disciples that said, hey, man, we don't know what you're talking about. What do you mean? And so then he would have to share it with them. Jesus knows that these disciples are about to have the whole rest of life to give for the gospel. Jesus knows in John 14 that your salvation is dependent upon what these disciples do with the rest of their life. Jesus also knows that once he leaves and he ascends into heaven, these men have become public enemy number one. He knows that they're going to have their skin filleted off of them. He knows that they're going to be boiled alive. He knows that they're going to be exiled. He knows that they're going to be killed for the gospel. So what can he say to these men who were aloof, who didn't even know where they were? We were talking this morning in Mark, and Jesus has to heal a demon-possessed man. And here's what Jesus says. Have you been with me so long? Why do I keep putting up with this generation that doesn't believe? His disciples are there. He knows that something has to encourage them to stick it out to the end. Don't waste your life. What's he do? He says, do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. And then here's what he says to him. In my Father's house, there are many, many dwelling places, mansions. If it weren't so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. If I go prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. Guys, so that where I am, you may be also. He knew those disciples were going to miss him. He knew those disciples, given their own vices, would quit. He knows in just a few hours, Peter's going to say, oh, yeah, I'll go to death with you. But he knows Peter's going to say, I don't know him. And you know what Jesus dangles out in front of these disciples to get the gospel out? You know what the carrot was that Jesus dangled so that you could come to know Jesus Christ? You know what the carrot was to those 11 men? Heaven. My children, you don't know what I'm talking about. You ever dealt with your kids and you had to promise them one thing to get them to do something else? Right? If you want your kids to eat broccoli,
but they want a cookie. But I want my cookie, Dad.
And I said, you got to eat your broccoli before you get that cookie. But I don't like broccoli. No, if you eat your broccoli, you can have this chocolate chip cookie. But I want my cookie, Dad. And my youngest one, who will remain nameless, is the worst. Dad, please, Dad. Oh, Dad. And, you know, eat your broccoli, Memphis. And then, that's a Tyler move right there. Eat your broccoli, Memphis. And you can have your cookie. Eat your broccoli, Memphis. I don't like broccoli. I don't like it. Eat your broccoli. Y'all know what I'm talking about. And then you take it out of the package and you put it right in front of the plate. You can have it if you eat your broccoli. No, and he wants to touch it. Get your hand back, boy. You ain't get that cookie until you eat your broccoli. You understand what I'm talking about? So he's just shoving it in there, and there's like little bits of broccoli on his chin. It's like the worst thing ever. Like he's allergic. Is my face swollen? No, just eat your broccoli, you know. So he can have the cookie. And you know what Jesus does to us? He says there's going to be a whole lot of broccoli, but you got to eat it to get the cookie. Boys, you got to go through the broccoli to get the cookie. Jesus understood that there's things in life that you have to walk through. You have to go through. You have to walk it. There's no way around it. You have to walk it. But why? Because at the end of the day, you get heaven. You got to stay in. You can't let it go. You get heaven. Don't waste your life. See, what happens is most of us get to the broccoli moments of life, and we go, I'm not going through it, but you get heaven. I ain't willing to do that. I'm not willing to. You know what you do? So you back off the broccoli, and you build your heaven here. But I'm telling you, there's coming a day that the heaven that you're building is going to burn. It's going to burn. It's going to burn up. The Bible says that when Christ comes, he's going to return, and we're going with him. But here's what's going to happen to this earth, and everything that you've ever built is going to burn up. It's not going to last. Why would you sell out for something that's going to burn up? See, many of us, you're going to go to bed tonight worried about the debt that you're in. You're going to worry about the bills that you're paying. You're going to worry about the light bill. You're going to worry about all that other kind of stuff. Won't it stink when you get to heaven and you realize that you stayed up all night worried about the heaven that you had and it burned up anyways? Eric Bacon's my insurance agent. Can you imagine if I was going to build a house and he was insuring it and he knew that in 3 weeks my house is going to burn down, but I said, no, I'm going to go ahead and build it anyways. And we'll just let it burn down. He'd say, you've lost your mind. I ain't paying for that. You knew. Some of you building your heaven here, and you're wasting your life. Listen to this, and we're done. Little book, Answers to Your Questions About Heaven, David Jeremiah. I'm using this for my personal on everything else that I'm studying. He says, during the Second World War, when it was hard for Franklin Roosevelt to travel among the troops because of his disability, First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt took his place, and she became a favorite of the soldiers around the world. She sent cables and letters back to FDR, becoming his eyes and ears. And on one such trip in the Pacific, she spent on an evening talking to a group of soldiers and later told her husband there was only one thought on all their minds. FDR said, tell me, are they staying in the fight? We got to win this fight. Tell me, Eleanor, are they doing okay? Tell me what it is. And she writes to her husband. She says, there's only one thought on every one of these soldiers' minds. It's this, the desire to finish the battle so they can go home. Jesus has a home for you. And all he's doing is saying, stay in the battle, because one day we're going to go home. He goes on and says this, because maybe your misconceptions messed you up, and I love this. This is what I got cold chills about. God is the most exciting, adventuresome, creative person that you can imagine. That's who God is. Multiplied 1,000 times over. We can't even comprehend a morsel of the excitement that is resident in the triune God with whom we are going to spend eternity. Now, the psalmist says that in his presence is the fullness of joy, and at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. Listen to this. Think about heaven. When we get to heaven, when we are in the presence of God, everything we do will bring about perfect satisfaction and reward. You ever look forward to something and got there and it was like, okay, it wasn't that great. He says, when you get there, it's perfect. It's perfect satisfaction. We will never engage in anything that leaves us feeling even a tad bit empty. Everything we do will bring us absolute and total fulfillment and joy, because that's the way God has created us. In fact, His Word says that God has put eternity in our hearts. What this means is that God has built us with a space within us that can't be satisfied with anything except heaven. And that's the reason we aren't going to be bored in heaven. For in everything our hearts long for is in heaven. In paradise, we will finally feel the completeness that we were created in joy. There's going to come a day where you're going to see me dead. And when that day comes, and they open this church up, and y'all come by to see you, Pastor, my body's there, I don't want you to cry. Well, I do. I want you to cry for a minute. Real hard. Get the paper down here. Let me see you crying. I've said whenever I die, I want them to pull my body like JFK through town. A horse. I want people to line the streets. I want my children to stand out and salute me as I go by. I do. Oh, God. They'll probably put me in the back of a truck, drive me over and drop me in something. I don't want you to cry. I'm looking forward to heaven. I'm looking forward to it. When I get to heaven, joy fulfilled. It's better than you can imagine. There's not one tiny bit of emptiness inside of me. When I bust into heaven, for the first time ever, I'm going to experience full joy. The Bible says that God has every pleasure forevermore at His right hand. You say, what does that mean? You got to come back in a few weeks to find out. But I'm telling you right now, there's nothing on this planet that can compete with what's waiting on me in heaven. And I hope that you can raise your eyes and begin to seek it. Will you bow your head and close your eyes? Some of you have friends and family in heaven. Can you wait to see them? Man, I can't. I'm just telling you, I can't. I can't wait. I think about my people. I can't wait to see him. But you know what? Sometimes I think about him and I think, I wonder if he's waiting on me. Can I tell you the truth? He's not. He's having the time of his life. I'm jealous. I think about some of the people that I know who have buried moms and dads, brothers and sisters. Some of the couples that I've walked through miscarriages with or lost babies. Their heart is consumed with it. But there's coming a day that we're going to walk through those gates. We're going to see it as it should be seen. And it's going to be greater than you could ever imagine. That everything that you work for here is never going to compare to what is there. Everything you ever work to build here is going to burn up. But that heaven that God has made for us, oh, man. I'm just telling you, it's worth going. Paul says, gain! Gain! I don't know if you're heavenly minded this morning, but I sure hope you are, because over the next several weeks, we're going to answer some questions. But the first thing we have to do is understand that this is important, and you need to know what heaven's all about. And I'm telling you, once you understand it, once you see it, I don't know that your heart can contain it. You're going to want to go so bad. God, I pray that you'd move during our time of invitation. Some people in here, they're just struggling because they know heaven is full of folks that they love. They've been struggling here on earth because their heaven was taken from them. Their heaven is with you. But maybe you're trying to just get them to look at you. May we not be so focused on earth that we miss out on heaven, but may we be so focused on heaven that you throw earth in on the way there. God, help us, focus us, move us. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand, let's sing.